Buonasera a tutti. It's a very great pleasure to welcome all of you tonight. I will start with some greetings of personalities from Venice, who are with us tonight. Prima di tutto vorrei esprimere il nostro più vivo saluto e ringraziamento a Sua Eccellenza il Prefetto, rappresentante del Governo, Domenico Cutaia, che ci onora con la sua presenza, e al Vice Sindaco, rappresentante del Sindaco di Venezia, Vice Sindaco Luciana Dal Colle. Grazie davvero per essere qui con noi. Poi abbiamo il Procuratore della Repubblica, Adelchi d'Ippolito, romano ma ormai veneziano, ha subito la stessa trasformazione che ho subito io, la direttrice dell'UNESCO Anna Luisa Thompson Flores, il vicepresidente della Fondazione Italia-Giappone Andrea Boragno, rappresentanti di molte università, quasi tutte le università associate, ma anche qualcuna in più. C'è per esempio anche, oltre a Ca' Foscari, la professoressa Ricciarda ricorda, c'è di Padova il rettore che ha retto quell'Ateneo per tanti anni, il professore Giuseppe Zaccaria, con il quale abbiamo poi negoziato l'ingresso di Padova qui alla VIU. Ma abbiamo anche il professor Anton Giulio De Robertis dell'Università La Sapienza di Roma. La direttrice dell'ufficio dell'Istituto Italiano di Cultura di Mosca, la professoressa Olga Strada, si trova per caso a Venezia e non abbiamo rinunciato al piacere e alla tentazione di invitarla con noi. Le do un caloroso benvenuto. E poi, come rappresentante della comunità ebraica di Roma, la dottoressa Clelia Piperno. Abbiamo anche la direttrice, vorrei salutarla, la direttrice del Museo Ebraico di Venezia, il centro studi tedesco di studi veneziani, Petra Schäfer, anche lei con noi, e vorrei salutarla, così come importanti esponenti del mondo culturale e economico di Venezia, in particolare Luca De Michelis. Luca De Michelis, come sapete, è l'editore di una prestigiosa casa editrice, Marsilio, che ha organizzato una delle più belle mostre mai organizzate a Venezia su Manuzio. This year we have the 500th anniversary of Aldo Manuzio, one of the greatest printers of history of ever appeared in this world. And the most beautiful exhibition of Aldo Manuzio was organized by Luca De Michelis at the Academia. I'm sorry for those who haven't seen it because it's now closed, but we hope to bring it somewhere, perhaps in America. It would be a wonderful show and a very popular one. Vorrei anche dire che abbiamo l'Enel, il dottor Mattia Carlin dell'Enel, e carissimi amici come il comandante Giovanni Maria Galofaro del Circolo Ufficiali. The most attractive club in town is the Navy Officers in Venice Club, just opposite on the other side of the water, and I give him a very warm welcome. E poi abbiamo il rappresentante del padrone di casa, l'ingegnere Andrea Berro, che è stato da poco designato presidente di San Servolo Servizi. E vorrei ringraziarlo per essere qui con noi. Ci auguriamo di avere una collaborazione molto stretta per raggiungere obiettivi sempre più ambiziosi e dare il nostro contributo alla vita veneziana. Bene, this event is mainly dedicated to you, very prestigious professors from our university's network, and to all your students. We are very pleased that nearly all the universities which belong to this network are here tonight. And I would like to say how pleased we are that among the professors there is also Virginia Zabo, who helped us create with Carolina Bruselius the first intermodality club which we have here in Venice, called Visualizing Venice. I wish you all to have a look at it. It's quite impressive, and it allows us to go very deeply into the history of Venice. Thank you very much indeed. Here in Venice, we have, for the past 20 years, developed a very unique model of transnational education, where professors and students come from different parts of the world in the single campus of San Servolo. Our open approach is very similar to the way that the Venice Republic has always adopted. It has encouraged the settlement of many foreign communities, giving them and putting at their disposal palaces that they call today Fontego, or Fondaco in Italian, where they have been able not only to find a new fatherland, but also to develop their own customs and traditions. Now, very close to here, there is another island called San Lazzaro. And if you want to know everything about this island, you should ask Professor Nubar Janigian, who's here, who knows perfectly well the abbot and the monks living there. It's the most ancient Armenian community, religious community in the world. And we're very proud that they are our neighbors here. But there are also the Germans in the Fontego dei Tedeschi, the Turks, the Greek community was settled around the church of San Giorgio dei Greci, and of course in the ghetto, the Jewish community. Now, I believe it is important to say that this approach that the Republic of Venice had, the open approach, was very visionary. It allowed people to keep their heritage, to actually develop it here, and to live peacefully one near the other. But they've also added all the riches that you see along the canals. Now, in a time like ours, of immigrations, where you see people coming, landing on the beaches, destitute, having lost all their property and their material well-being. We are moved by charity, but we also consider them a threat. And this is a very great mistake, because they have not lost everything. They may have lost what they left behind in their own country, but they bring with them their cultural heritage, their history, the history of their country, what they somehow is their national development and their national belonging. Now, we should accept them in the same way that we, in the past, the Republic accepted all different people, but not on individual terms, as a community, in telling them and making them understand how important their heritage is, how important it is for themselves to keep, and important for us to understand, because it's their dignity which is at stake. If we consider them only from the point of view of people who need help, who need money, who need to be somehow fed and hosted, we are giving a very poor image of these people, whereas they come from countries where today there is a war or conflicts, but it's the countries which remind, when you think of them, you remind of Mesopotamia, 3,000 years of civilization, of very ancient civilizations. And we must accept them and teach them and make them understand that we have not forgotten that they have their own dignity, they've got their own individuality, in the same way the Armenian monks have been able to develop here for nearly 1,000 years. This is what I wanted to say. And I say this because the mayor of Venice, only a few days ago, invited here many mayors from the Mediterranean and Northern Europe and gave them the chance to explain how they see the problems of migrations today, how they experience this enormous rise in numbers of people whose mobility has become so easy thanks to planes, thanks to ships, thanks to trains. And it was an extraordinary event. And it reminded me what he said in his message, which is very similar to the message that you find when you enter one of the medieval gates in Siena, which says, Cor magis tibi sena pandit, which means this gate is large, but Siena offers you a greater heart than this gate. I think that this is the approach that Venice has also held, not only for some minorities, but for all minorities. And this is why I'm so pleased that Donatella Calabi accepted, who is a great expert in this field. She has produced the richest catalog ever on the ghetto of the 500 years of the ghetto here in Venice. And she has allowed all our students and professors today to visit the exhibition at the Ducal Palace. But I would like to say that this is the message which we share with the mayor and the municipality of Venice. We have to keep, in Europe particularly, this very open approach, this very open acceptance of people who arrive deprived of everything, but not of their dignity and their history. And this is why this semester, which opens today, which will give you a chance, referring now to the students, will have you a chance to see how rich this environment has become, thanks to the presence here in Venice of so many different communities. Well, let me wish you a very interesting and pleasant time. No one forgets ever the time spent here. We are lucky to see many students come back 2 or 3 years later to say, oh, I was here. The room where I used to work, it was this one. And my apartment on the island is in this particular building or that other building. It shows how much this sense of community is shared between us. And I really do hope that you will keep and treasure wonderful memories of this unique experience in a campus which has no equal in the world. It's the only university where universities don't work from time to time together. They work 365 days a year together with their own programs, with their own teaching, with their own professors, but this time in a very international campus together with the other colleagues from many other countries. So let me say how grateful I am for having come so numerous today. It is a great pleasure to see so many present here. It means that somehow our connections with Venice have become stronger and stronger. Vi ringrazio davvero tutti, vorrei ringraziare il sindaco attraverso la gentile Luciana Colle, vice sindaco, tutte le autorità presenti, al prefetto un grazie sentito e a tutti voi per essere venuti all'apertura di questo semestre. Grazie davvero.
Thank you very much, Umberto, for your words that are, as usual, very, very inspiring. I was thinking many different things while you were speaking about Venice, the history, and the multicultural setting, and these exchanges. And I would like to say, probably, apart from the notion of ghetto, everything can be translated into the VIU. Experience, in fact, these ideas of course, different scale, different time, different context, but this idea of the multicultural environment in which people coming from different places can exchange experiences with the professors being here, as you said, at the same time, students being here in the same class, even, and not only not in a single class, in many different classes where students are from different universities, different countries, and sharing their experience and learning something as you said, and whether this is really kind of unique situation. But I was also thinking something going to my disciplinary background and my research experience. Everything can be translated in completely different words, but in fact describing the same thing. When we do research or we teach a system dynamics, for example, we think about systems, no? And something we teach about what a system is that a system is not a collection of things, it's not a collection of elements. It's not that, just that. There must be interaction. Otherwise, it's just an ensemble of things. But if interaction is there, then we can call that a system. And this is what we can say when we try to implement these kind of approaches here. We do everything we can to stimulate these kind of interactions between the different actors that we have here, the students, professors, and the wonderful staff that we have working here.
Thank you very much. May I simply say that Carlo Giupponi is the new dean of Venice International University. He has been here, as he reminded us, 6 months. But we have here, and I just noticed in the audience, Agar Brugiavini, who has been a very also efficient dean of these universities. And I would like to greet her. At the same time, I would like to mention Ignazio Musu, who has been also a long-time dean of this university. We are very grateful to all those who have helped build in time this unique experience. And we do not forget them. And this is why last year we had wonderful celebrations for the 20th anniversary of Venice International. Now, may I give the floor to the representative of the mayor, Luciana Colle, thanking her again.
Buonasera a tutti e a tutte. Io parlerò in italiano, non mi sono preparata niente in inglese. Ringrazio innanzitutto il presidente Umberto Vattani e il preside Carlo Giupponi per il graditissimo invito. Porgo il saluto del sindaco Luigi Brugnaro, che mi ha chiesto di rappresentarlo in questa graditissima occasione, oltre al mio personale, e il saluto anche dell'assessore al turismo Paola Mar, che purtroppo è stata demandata dal sindaco ad altro impegno istituzionale proprio all'ultimo momento, ma che avrebbe gradito molto essere presente a questa importante cerimonia. È appunto per me un motivo di immenso piacere essere presente e intervenire a questa appunto importante cerimonia, perché è una di quelle volte in cui si ascoltano e si imparano tante cose che non è uso ascoltare durante i lavori di un'amministrazione o una città. La città di Venezia, anche in prospettiva metropolitana, sa di poter contare su una decisa e illustre presenza universitaria, fonte di assoluto credito, motivo di eccellenza per la ricerca e formazione, un modello che può vantare una decisa connotazione internazionale e globale. Questi fondamentali presupposti sono le basi per poter lasciare, con incedere sicuro, le nostre azioni verso il futuro, continuando la necessaria e costante attività a favore delle genti e dei territori. È indubbio che un'opera di forte presenza di istituzioni in grado di promuovere lo studio, l'innovazione, l'aggregazione e la formazione piena della persona, soprattutto in una dimensione di piena appartenenza alla comunità mondiale, è elemento portante per l'attività di sviluppo di qualsiasi campo. Quindi rinnovo il ringraziamento alla Venice International University per la preziosa attività che svolge nella città e per la città. Grazie. Grazie.
Sindaco, grazie per le sue parole. Vorrei pregare adesso la professoressa Donatella Calabi, molto nota qui a VIU. She has been a professor at VIU many, many years. And as I said before, she's quite an extraordinary expert on the history of Venice. Thank you very much, Donatella.
Thank you very much, Umberto Vattani, the Ambassador Umberto Vattani. Thank you to the Dean of the VIU. Thank you to the Vice Mayor of Venice and to all the authorities that Umberto mentioned. I will not mention again all the authorities. Thank you to everybody. Thank you to you all, ladies and gentlemen, and all the friends which I see here in the hall. Perhaps you know that the title of my speech today, this evening, is Venice, a Cosmopolitan City, meaning to take in account mainly the beginning, the period between the end of the 15th and the the beginning of the 17th century. So the most important period of the institution of the ghetto. You know, it was already mentioned that we are now in the fifth centenary of the institution of the ghetto, 2016, 516, the beginning of the ghetto. I was charged by a committee, citizen committee, to organize some events, some initiatives in the city during this year. We had a lot of conferences, of dialogues, of encounters, of theater performances, and an exhibition at the Ducal Palace to remember this event of the institution of the ghetto. It's not something to be celebrated. We insisted a lot on this, but it's something to remember. And what was really important during this year was a kind of collaboration among the different institutions in Venice. The municipality is an important one, the VIU, the German Center for Venetian Studies, the Fondazione di Venezia, Save Venice, Berg Foundation, a kind of institutions engaged in the Venetian history. For a while, we had a proper collaborations among these different institutions for these different initiatives. And myself, I was really engaged as curator of the exhibition at the Ducal Palace. I gave this title, Venice as a Cosmopolitan City, because I think that the Jewish ghetto has to be seen in the framework of the city at the beginning of the 16th, end of 15th and beginning of 16th century as a place where you had a lot, already Umberto Vattani mentioned, a lot of different immigrants waves, a lot of different minorities located in the city and located within the city with the important attitude by the Venetian Republic. But first of all, I would like to come back to the word ghetto. Those who were this morning at the exhibitions, I mentioned already the origin of this word, which has in principle nothing to do with segregation, nor with the Jewish presence, but it was simply a name of a place. This is important to be taken in account. In the exhibition, here you have simply the map of the apartments, the ducal apartments, where the exhibition is organized. At the exhibition, we emphasized the role of the term ghetto, because today I think that we use, with the worldwide use, the term of ghetto for quite different situations, and this is rather confusing. I mean that we have in mind a kind of a physical and social isolation, but the ghetto for the black people in Chicago, the ghetto of the northern part of the Mediterranean areas in the North African countries, the ghettos as periphery of the very important capital cities, the ghetto in Warsaw in the Nazi period, and the ghetto of Venice are completely different. And I think that use the same term is to mention all these different situations is rather confusing. In fact, I think that this term is a kind of blanket term for that very different situations that may be remote both from a geographical and from a political and economical point of view. When we decided to remember the story, the long story, 500 years of the Jewish ghetto in Venice, we had the intention to underline also a lot of contradictions, a lot of complexity, a lot of porosity and openness of the ghetto. It's a paradox, but I think it's important to be taken in mind. The meaning of segregation, of course, it's there, but and it's important to reflect nowadays, on the meaning of that gradually assumed by this term of ghetto and of segregation. And perhaps the story of the Jewish ghetto in Venice could help us in reflecting to this kind of meanings of the different term of segregation. Today, we in the newspapers, in the television, in the media, the ghetto is perceived as a very dangerous place and conditioned by precariousness from economical and social point of view, and usually characterized by levels of immigration. Nonetheless, very often, these kind of ghettos where still are potentially multicultural and have the character of giving some opportunities of meetings, exchanges, and coexistence available to people of different origins. I would like to focus on this. Here I would like to remember some very short phrases I will quote from rather well-known scholars, sociologists or historians, such as Richard Sennett, Salvatore Settis, Simon Sciama, mentioned the ghetto of Venice as the experience of the Jews of the Venetian ghetto suggested a way to mesh cultural and political rights destined to endure in times. In what was then, and I am quoting, the most cosmopolitan city in Europe, indeed, the first global city in the early modern world, the ghetto community developed a sense of mutual solidarity and forms of collective representation based on a knowledge of their own rights. In doing so, they made the Venetian enclosure the general emblem of a place in which freedom of speech tended to coincide with the right to be in the city. It's maybe a way rather different from the usual way of considering the ghetto that we have in mind. A second point, which is important for me, becoming familiar with this long story of the ghetto of Venice is the character that Jewish identity is really an integral part of the European identity. And I think that we can say this in a very clear-cut way. 27 years after the fall of the wall of Berlin, 1989, in a free and reunited continent, at least in principle, which, however, is incapable of governing the many and huge waves of immigrants, this realization the realization of the Jewish ghetto of Venice may contribute to tackling the challenge now facing not only Europe, but the Western world, in fact. The challenge of avoiding a new age of concrete barriers and barbed wire fences, and obviating, if possible, the danger of a worldwide archipelago of ghettos. So I think that these kind of considerations of the ghetto today were very important for the Jewish community and for all of us who were engaged in the organization of the initiatives of the fifth centenary in a very important way. To be free individuals means to be able to leave their own state, carrying with them their own roots. After all, this was the attitude that Jews were capable to bring with them during centuries. The decision of institute the Ghetto of Venice was taken in 1516 by the Republic of Venice in a very complex and complicated period in which you had a lot of different attitudes. The welcoming of different foreigners was rather important in this period, end of the 15th, beginning of 16th century, by the magistrate of the Venetian Republic. And we tried to describe all this in the exhibition through history, art, and documentary evidence. The great ghetto itself, the way how it grew on itself, the architecture, the social makeup, the crafts and trades, the everyday material life, the relationships between Jewish minority and the rest of the city. The background of the relationships between the Jewish Venetian community and the other Jewish communities in Europe and in the Mediterranean basin and the rest of the city. And we found a kind a relative level of permeability, of openness, and cultural relationships and exchanges. The idea in the exhibition was to offer to visitors this kind of story, which is probably rather different from the normal story of the Jewish ghetto. What it was important for us is to underline the urban strategy by the Republic of Venice, dealing with the juridical laws and rules, for instance, the rights of marriage or the rights of accede to different trades and crafts. Together with this, the Republic of Venice focused also on real proper urban strategy. I mean, in terms of physical settlements, which means buildings, districts, giving to the different foreigner communities a location where to live in, where to make business, and to be rather secure, knowing very well that among different people, having different origins, different behavior, it's you can have different kind of conflicts, contrast and conflicts. So the idea of giving a location and separate the different communities from the rest of the city and of citizens was for the Republic of Venice quite important. In fact, you saw in the video the map, the original map by Jacopo de Barbari, which is the most important map for the 15th century, the beginning of 16th, in fact. In the map, you can locate very well and very in a very clear-cut way the location of the different minorities. Were already mentioned the warehouses. You had the warehouses for German people, for Persian people. German people means also the Flemish people coming from Low Countries, but at the same time the Persian people, the Turks, and we will see Turks does it mean, some different districts for Greek Orthodox Greeks, for the place for Armenian, already mentioned, the Albanians, the people from the other Italian states. You have to keep in mind that Italy was not Italy, not a new, a unique state, but having different states with different government. So people coming from Florence, from Ferrara, from Milano, from Lucca, dealing with the commerce in Venice. The most important word used in the archive documents is these people are useful. And the term useful is rather significant, I think, useful for the commercial activities of this city. When the Doge Leonardo Loredan signed the decree to push the Jews to live together in the district of the ghetto, this decree came just after, 1 year after, the permission for Jews to buy shops in the right central area of the market, being there really linked to the market activity. They were mainly pawnbrokers. The pawnbroker activity was really very important for a commercial city, not only for the poor people who had to engage their jewels, but for the noblemen and even for the republic itself, who had who needed money, fresh money, for the period of crisis. At the same time, you had a period of uncertainty. And conflicting behaviors. For instance, the Patriarch of Venice, Contarini, was against the Jews. So you had the different attitudes and conflicting attitudes. Some noblemen and even the Doge in favor of Jews and of different communities, while you had the Patriarch, but other noble families against Jews, but at the same time against the Greek Orthodox or the sale of books by Luther, Martin Luther, in the bookstores of Venice. So you have really different attitudes, and this complexity is something which has to be taken in account. I think it's very important. In my presentation, I would like, for this reason, to maintain the fact that Jews could go beyond the ghetto, and the regulation established for them by the Venetian Republic before and during the life of the enclosure, even in the relationships with the rest of the city. And it's important to consider the Jewish ghetto in the framework of this rather complex ensemble of the whole city. At the same time, certainly this place became a place of identity for the community, for the Jewish community, a kind of contrada within the other contradas, a sort of partitions. Partition within the city. The city was full of different partitions. Usually in the middle of each contrada you have the parish church. In this case you had the synagogues. But in fact it was a kind of small city within the city, having a lot of different services, of course the synagogues, all the educational services, the assistential services, very important in the Jewish cultural activity or attitude, and a lot of shops. Being then a district poor from the building character, for different reasons. Nobody was really responsible for this kind of buildings. The Jews never had the ownership of their home, of their housing. So nobody was really interested to invest in buildings, nor the owners, because they were sure that their housing were rented to the Jews, nor the rentals, because they were not owners. So nobody was really interested to invest in this kind of buildings. The buildings are really quite poor. They are also quite poor from a point of view of the construction for physical reasons. You have to take in mind that Venice is a not solid city. I mean, the land is not solid, it's sand. And in a very restricted district, Jews began to be 700, became very quickly in 60 years, 3,000. So they had to raise buildings in highness very quickly. And this raising of buildings, the skyscrapers, so-called skyscrapers of Venice, were raised in a very bad way of constructing. Thin walls, thin levels, floors, low distance between the floor and the ceiling, So sometimes 2 meters, even 180. So it's really constructed in bad conditions. But at the same time, was really very rich in terms of services, of all kinds of services, cultural, religious, assistential, and even shops. And I will arrive to the idea of cosmopolitan ghetto, but I will come back soon on this. Because you had different communities. I mean, in the ghetto, you had several different communities, but I will come back soon on this. In fact, you had the Republic of Venice had also magistrates specifically dedicated to the foreigners. The Curia del Forestier is a magistrate defined to give responsible for monitoring foreign settlements, regulations, social, economical, institutional regulations, and the relationships between the foreigners and the rest of the city. And I think that this should be taken in account as a kind of reorganization strategy by the Venetian Republic, the Venetian government, imposed between the mid-15th century and the end of the 17th. Coming to the different foreigners, you heard maybe of the Riva degli Schiavoni, is the name of a place. Gli Schiavoni, coming from Schiavonia, are the Dalmatian people coming from Dalmatia. So there was a Dalmatian community, and the Dalmatian community had an hospital, Santa Caterina, and restored in 1451, between 1451 and 55, and all around housing around the hospital of Santa Caterina. Then the Albanian, having since the end of 15th century a specific siege nearby to Santo Stefano and the Church of Santo Stefano. Then the warehouses, already mentioned, the German and the Flemish warehouse, where you had not only the merchants, of course the merchants were important, but also very important cultural figures, for instance, painters. Albrecht Dürer is maybe a person that you had in mind, whose name you have in mind. Albrecht Dürer was resident in the Fondaco dei Tedeschi and in relationships with the main important painters of the Venetian painters of the same age, Giorgione, Titian, Bellini, Carpaccio, and so on. Or musicians, the musician of the Chapel of San Marco, Van Villert, Flemish, was resident in the Fondaco dei Tedeschi. So these places were really places of cultural exchanges among them and the city, among other people within the city. The Fondaco of Persians, quite near in San Giovanni Crisostomo. And then the Ottoman Empire, and the fondaco, the warehouses for the Ottoman Empire was again very complex, because people coming from the Ottoman Empire are coming from Bosnia, from Persia, from Albania, from Anatolia, from the eastern part of Greece. So it's again a very complex and maybe full of contrast and maybe conflictual place, where to keep separate people was really an aim by the Republic of Venice and by the communities themselves. The Armenian, already mentioned, nearby the Calle degli Armeni, the parish of San Zulian, the hospice destined for them, between the 15th and the 17th century, a lot of different movements in the city. A cemetery, cemetery for the Armenians, and so on. And their most important activities, which is the printing. Still now, the typography is something that is quite linked to the Armenian community. The Greek Orthodox, those among you who were this morning in the exhibition, have seen a very important document that I always quote, which is a petition. Petition by the Greek Orthodox community to the Senate of the Republic to obtain the permission to realize the church, the Greek Orthodox Church, 1525, 9 years after the institution of the ghetto, and they say, the Greek Orthodox say, we want to be treated by the Senate of the Republic as the heretic Armenian and the infidel Jews. So this perception that it was possible to compare the different communities is not only our point of view following the documents, but was really a perception by themselves, even the ancient communities, in this case the Orthodox Greek community, had the perception that they wanted to be treated as the Jews, as the Armenian. This seems to me very important. Moreover, as I mentioned briefly before, the idea that even the ghetto was a cosmopolitan ghetto. You had in the ghetto different communities. The first communities were mainly the Italian and the German communities, with Jewish, German, and Italian communities. But afterwards, and quite quickly, in 1541, when the second ghetto was opened, usually we speak about ghetto. In fact, the ghetto were three. You had three different ghettos, three extensions of the ghetto, and for different immigrant waves. So in the second ghetto, you had mainly Spanish and Portuguese Jews. And in the third ghetto, the Ghetto Nuovissimo, 1633, you had mainly people coming from Greece and from Ottoman Empire. All these communities were absolutely different in terms of behavior, of cultural attitude, of food. They ate really in a very different way. They all of them were eating kasher, but kasher of different in different waves ways, and different languages. They even didn't understand each other. People coming from Germany and speaking Yiddish couldn't understand the Spanish people speaking a very peculiar language called Judeo-Spagnolo, a mixture between Spanish and Hebrew, or Venetian. Also, the Venetian language is quite mixed to this. So these people were all Jews, but all different and quite different, having sometimes contrast and conflicts one each other. So the aim by the Jewish community, the University of Jews, and the attitude by the Republic of Venice was to try to keep them, even them, relatively separate in the three different ghettos. This was completely difficult because the restriction of the area, it was really a small area. So you had a lot of abuses and invasions of different spaces and places. So I insist on the contradictions because it seems to me that the rules are very important, but when you have to deal with the story of a city, the logic of the city is overlapping the regulations, and the story of abuses is, for me, maybe more important than the story of regulations. Anyway, I think that it's possible to speak about cosmopolitan ghetto, where differently from the usual way, maybe, to define a ghetto, the opportunities of meetings, of exchanges, and the coexistence were really available to people of different origins. And thank you very much. For these illustrations, just quickly, I decided to propose to you simply a kind of synthesis of the exhibition at the Ducal Palace. Some of you already have seen it, some of you not yet. The exhibition is open until the 13th of November. You are all invited to go and have a look directly. The exhibition is organized mainly on original documents. When I speak about original documents, I have in mind paintings, drawings, written documents, and books. But at the same time, a lot of multimedia devices to try to explain to a large public, not necessarily of experts, at the contrary, generic people interested to the subject, what the original documents would like to say. And my ambition was always also to speak to the young people, as you are, children. And I took them there, very often children, schools, to try to explain this kind of a very complex story even to young people and to children. Thank you.
tutti noi sapevamo benissimo che una presentazione della professoressa Donatella Calabi sarebbe stata, ci avrebbe tenuto col fiato sospeso. We hadn't imagined it would have been so exciting. And I would like to thank all those who have followed her in the visit to the Ducal Palace exhibition this morning. Let me again, on all your behalf, thank Donatella Calabi for having given us such a wonderful experience and having gone back in time to the early arrival of the Jewish community in this country. It has been the first example ever of a very civilized way of accepting people. Of course, could have been better. We're not nostalgic about the ghetto, but we must recognize that nevertheless, together with other minorities, it has been a wonderful possibility for many of them to keep their traditions, their customs, develop further their talents. And therefore, it's a wonderful example for the whole world. Let me again thank you for having come so numerous today. I would like to thank the Dean for the great help he's giving to the university in directing your curriculum and your studies, and again to say how pleased to see we are to see so many of you here. Agar, it's been a pleasure to have you again on the spot together with Ignazio Musu, and I do hope that many of you will keep coming back. Nubar Janigian is a very good example of the type of friendship bonds that we have established through time. And thanks to him, to the island next door. And I advise you, when you have a little time, to make a stopover in the San Lazzaro Island. It's worth seeing and visiting. And the abbots will be most best hosts to you all. Thank you very much, and I wish you a wonderful evening. Thank you. Grazie.